Conceptualization within Loewe's ballads, which lead listeners to a place of introspection and reminiscence. Erlkönig from 1821 was one of the first ballads written by Karl Loewe and serves as a fantastic entry point in any discussion of the musical artist and his life's work. The prolific composer found contentment in a life built around tradition and the inwardness of an existence centered around his religion. These attributes of sincere conservative values and their inherently introspective command upon one's life found their way into his compositions. In addition to this retrospective and Innerlichkeit-fueled style, a vast majority of Loewe's writing was for himself to play and sing, the ultimate of inward acts. The composer utilized leitmotifs and various folk music-inspired musical devices, along with other compositional techniques, and combined them with poetry imbued with nostalgic and introspective elements to produce ballads of unrivaled quality and pedagogical value. Loewe's focus on interiority and Innerlichkeit can be experienced most acutely in the ballads presented here. So, what exactly is meant by interiority? Where does it come from? How has it been applied to artistic works in the past? And how is it applicable to Loewe's ballads? The concept of interiority crept into the vernacular of poets and writers alike during the latter half of the 18th century. However, this notion associated with the inner self, as opposed to the outer world, had long been an undercurrent in philosophical and religious circles. Over two millennia ago, the Stoics of ancient Greece shared their concepts of virtue through good deeds, preaching to the masses a sort of inner or interiority-based self-focus that must be well aligned with nature itself and the natural order of life. Medieval mystics in the Christian and Jewish faiths also believed in a concept of interiority with their focus on the soul of a person and its individual connection with God, as opposed to a more mass-driven, exteriority-led actualization of faith. Theirs was a more secretive route to God through the divinity found within each individual. Martin Luther, especially in his later writings, also discussed the inner self versus the outer, as well as the inner word contrasted with the outer word. This philosophy of the individual and the goodness one brings into the world from within oneself, as opposed to the exteriority-based teachings of a religious institution, rose to prominence throughout Europe during the 17th and 18th centuries. Thus, interiority came to be associated with the intimate, inward, nostalgic, introspective, temporal, and often spiritual elements within music or literature. After the exteriority and outwardness attributed to the classical era and its creations, poets, authors, and composers alike yearned to dive deeper into the interior world of sentiment and emotions. As the rise of Romanticism took hold, many composers sought to return to the more personal and inward aspects, analogous with nature and other attributes of Innerlichkeit, through the utilization of folk tunes, folk tales, medieval imagery, spiritual journeys, and the like. It was not until the early 18th century that the concept of inwardness and one's emotions were intrinsically tied to the psyche of the individual, rather than an external force set upon a person. There are mentions of inwardness, or Innerlichkeit, and interiority in centuries past and writings to support this. The famed poet Johann Goethe began to use the term Innerlichkeit in regard to a poetic technique around 1787. Now, Loewe utilized the poetry of Goethe more than any other literary source for his ballads and songs, and the two artists had a fairly close relationship, sharing letters as well as interactions in person. In his autobiography, the composer mentions being captivated and inspired by the writer's artistic vision and concepts. Thus, he went on to utilize dozens of the poet's creations. Karl Loewe was, by all evidence, a gregarious small-town boy growing up in Luyun, Germany. The village remains extremely small to this day and still revolves around its most famous native son. His life was filled with music in every breath, religious practice in every day, and nature in every step. From the moment he was born into a family of 12 siblings and two very musically accomplished parents. From Loewe's earliest works, according to his own writings, he forged a close relationship with the church and the inner peace which a personal connection of that sort can bring. He writes at length about time spent with his family in front of the hearth, sharing folk tales and ballads of the spirit world, while also lifting their human spirits through the singing of hymns and reading together of the Bible. It is this interiority of family life and the inward comforts it provided, along with music, religion, and nature, that most influenced this curious young boy. After spending a handful of years studying in the city of Köthen, Loewe moved to Halle at age 13. His time in this city of music, especially those spent at university, were the most pivotal and poignant of his life. According to the composer himself, it was during this period from 1817 to 1819 that he fully brought to bear his years of careful musical, philosophical and theological studies. It was also at the university where he met his future bride, Julia von Jacob, and where he composed, arguably, his most famous and impactful ballad composition, Erlkönig. The composer struggled to balance his focus on theological studies, heavily supported by his father, and his inner desire to pursue music full-time. While the months progressed at university, Loewe's inward passion for music refused to be extinguished. He made the agonizing decision to forego his theological education and turn his sights to music making as the chief driver of his future. Loewe followed what he described as being the true and righteous route for himself. Upon marrying his beloved Julie and passing the necessary examinations, Loewe was placed in the position of Kirchenmusikdirektor at the St. Jakob's Church in Stettin, to the north in Germany, where he would remain for the next 46 years. Upon the untimely death of the composer's wife in 1823, Loewe swung into a deep depression. His pain and inner turmoil eventually subsided upon meeting a young soprano named August Lang. Their eventual marriage would be a happy and very long one, as evidenced by numerous correspondence in his autobiography. Loewe took comfort in the routines and simple joys of small-town life and was filled with a sense of affection and innerlichkeit for his home. The composer's enduring faith in God, his sincere piety, they both guided and informed every aspect of his introspective life and interiority-based compositional style. And that would render him unable to leave his dear Stettin to seek wider fame and fortune. From Loewe's Opus 2, published the same year as Opus 1 in 1821, we now present Herr Ohlins. Thank you. Surroundings. This desired emotional outcome was inspired by the combined text and music, drawing what was outward inward. These temporal tales generally dwelt in the collective memory and were bound by their subject matter, often a route by which poets and composers could connect with a shared nationalistic character and insinuate a mythical Germanic past. Ballads were originally based on anonymous texts and passed down through generations of minstrel singers, connecting and weaving a tapestry of shared emotion and imagination amongst their listeners. Numerous details within Loewe's compositions set him apart from fellow ballad composers. Unlike the Lied, the art ballad, as created by Loewe, individualizes each character, imbuing them with a sense of personality, humanity, and emotion, all aimed at drawing the listener inward to the plot and the emotion of the piece itself. By utilizing this route of characterization through musical terms and musical drama, Loewe created a form that was separate and distinct from the more popular ballad or Volkslied, where the same melody is often assigned to every verse. As the author Albert Bach indicates, the proper art ballad needs to include three main components: a dramatic narrative, a sense of the epic, and elements of lyricism. Now, Loewe managed to utilize all of these elements within his earliest endeavors at setting ballad poetry in 1817 and 1818 with Erlkönig, Edvard, and Die vierten Töchterlein. The composer furthers the case for interiority within his ballads through his choice of text from classic, medieval, and ancient sources, usually based on the supernatural, nature, religion, or folklore, all of which point toward introspection and Innerlichkeit, focusing from the outward inward. The compositions utilized here highlight the various ways that Loewe was able to accomplish this feat and imbue his ballads with a balance of Innerlichkeit as well as self-essence. Erlkönig is a supernatural legend based on a widely known and commonly shared folktale known by most throughout Germany at the time of Loewe's composition through either Goethe's version or the original Herder translation. Herr Oluf was also based on a folktale and shares some of the same characters as Erlkönig. The third piece discussed here today, Die verfallene Mühle, is a bittersweet and nostalgic tale of a long, long ago past with dukes on horseback, maids at the mill, and other such characters of a medieval bent, meant to stir emotion within the listener, not so much through their familiarity as a generational folktale, but to the feelings it elicits and the inwardness and introspection this evokes. Thus, this ballad, in particular, creates the image of the past as more inviting and emotionally stable. Fourth, Der Teufel draws on various religious aspects and a classic good versus evil storyline. an interiority-based tool with its appeal to someone's most personal beliefs and inherent introspection, such a ballad evokes. Loewe employed various devices to further this sense of interiority within his ballads, heard through his vast application of preludes, interludes, postludes, recitativo-inspired sections of the vocal line, leitmotifs, inventive harmonies, and symbolic use of differing keys, thus solidifying his imaginative genius at representing the qualities of the poetry and the poet's true intentions. Loewe is considered by most to be the first to incorporate leitmotifs as instruments of the storytelling within his ballads, drawing the outside audience or subject matter inward. Akin to the ballad itself, a leitmotif is intrinsically interior in its very meaning. It is meant to recur throughout time within a musical composition and recall a certain character, time, or place within a listener's memory. Now, whether that be to provoke a memory from the composition itself or to inspire a retrospective occurrence within the audience and their personal life experiences. Through a layering technique of interiority on various levels, Loewe reeled in his listeners by first choosing text that was well known to his public. He continued the process and built emotional capital through his use of structural uniqueness, phrasal shape, harmonic innovation, and leitmotivic usage, thereby painting a world within his ballads which had previously been unexplored. Loewe's aim was simply to get to the heart of the matter through the text at hand and conjure a dramatically epic ballad that allowed the listener to experience, on a personal level, the innerlichkeit woven into each note of his score. Loewe's relationship with and unwavering devotion to his faith would abide and sustain him throughout his lifetime, creating a deeply personal, inward, and interior connection with these integral aspects of his everyday existence and music. Loewe's Kirche music director position and the inherent obligations attached stand out as the foremost reason he repeatedly turned inward to his religious beliefs as a guide both for his life and his career as a composer. His youth and developmental years coincide with the rise of interiority in the early 19th century, just as it was taking root in most aspects of the arts and philosophical conversations. Loewe's upbringing and long association with the church affected greatly his interiorization of Martin Luther's notions of an inner faith, inwardness of emotion, and connection to one's soul. Our third ballad this afternoon is Loewe's setting of Die verfallene Mühle from 1847.
Nur
closer look now at the ballads performed today and dive into them just a little more analytically, pointing out the various instances of interiority and Innerlichkeit within each example. We started off with Löwe's earliest composition from 1817, based on Goethe's popular poem, Erlkönig. Now, Goethe's intentions are clear from his various letters in regard to ballads, where he lays out his belief that a ballad of lasting import will be something familiar to its audience, a folktale or Volkslied, for example. It is this sense of interiority, emotional intimacy, and familiarity born of the poetry itself that Löwe wished to imbue within his compositions. Erlkönig, in some form or other, had long been in the blood of Germans through their extensive traditional ballad knowledge. Therefore, Löwe returned the listener back in time, around the hearth with family, as folktales were spun. And the composer draws the audience inward as the plotline unfurls from the outer, natural landscape to the inner, emotional intricacies of the poem. The listener's attention is focused ever more acutely on the boy, his fear and interior experience, alone and sinking ever inward until his eventual collapse and death. Erlkönig itself could be viewed as a sort of psychoanalysis of humanity and the differing psychological forces at play within the characters Löwe and Goethe portray. It could also be regarded as a ballad of good versus evil, or father versus son. A timeless tale, either way you look at it, and one of the most interiority-laden based plot lines in literature. Soon after the ballad begins, we hear the boy's first cries. A plaintive piano, alarming in its near whisper, unnerving in its helpless quality, as he describes the Erlkönig's otherworldly appearance. As so often is the case with parents, the father seems to be merely half listening at this point, and quickly suggests that the child's inner fears and visions are merely that, an interior sensation and something to be ignored. One of the more shudder-inducing elements of Löwe's adaptation of this classic folktale is present as we first hear from the Erlkönig himself. The composer chooses for him to arrive in the parallel major key of G, accentuating the nightmarish quality of the spirit in this twist of tonality. Unlike the driving horse hooves or the trembling half cries of the son's vocal line, the Erlkönig's line conjures an entity suspended in time and space. The spirit's alluring yet equally repulsive music hovers simply within a G major triad, while its underlying accompaniment suspends all harmonic motion. The hushed yet guttural quality experienced here goes further to suggest the interiority of the moment as the Erlkönig's seduction grows, along with the horrific intimacy the spirit yearns to create between himself and the boy. The listener's focus is turned ever inward as one questions the very existence of this seductive and terrifying Erlkönig. Could he simply be a figment of the son's imagination? Löwe keeps the listener guessing through his use of this triadic tonic vocal line and the tremolo figure as musical devices of suggestion. Something or someone is coming, yet we are uncertain of what or who that may be. The timeless and definitive struggle between good and evil, the son and the Erlkönig, and son and father is filled with interiority and Innerlichkeit. Based originally on a Danish folktale and translated by Goethe, the story of the Erlkönig arose originally from ancient stories of creation, gods and mortals, Odin, the battle for good versus evil, light versus darkness. With the spirit's final lines, he completes his seduction and interiorization of the son. His vocal part overlaps with the boy's final cry by route of the only note in the entire ballad where the Erlkönig leaves his deceptive and mysterious tonic G major triad leitmotif. as the Spirit exclaims that he will use force if the son is unwilling to submit. He envelops the boy's own E-flat, leading to G minor, the son's tonality, from his own duplicitous G major, thus showing the outer world his inner, truly horrifying nature. Loewe further accentuates the boy's inner pain and spiritual struggle with his accents on the word lights, creating a discordant emotional jolt against the accompaniment dominant with a flat ninth. The narrator's final word in the ballad, tot, lies on a B natural, a note associated throughout the entire piece with the Earl King himself. It seems that the inner darkness discussed by Martin Luther, alluded to in the original Danish poem and more ancient foundations of the Erlkönig tale, has finally won. This musical personification of nature and the seductive yet terrifying characteristics of the spirit itself aim to make the story come to life within the memory of each listener, reminiscing either in enjoyment or alarm at this retelling of a folktale recital goers of Loewe's era grew up hearing. Loewe's Opus 2 from 1821 includes the popular folklore-based ballad poetry of Herr Ulf. This piece further solidifies the composer's use of leitmotif and narrative style, aimed at personifying the characters and connecting further with intended audiences. The text, also very likely to be familiar to audiences of the era, was translated from the original Danish by Herder, and is the same storyline that Goethe reset to create his ballad version of Erlkönig. Loewe utilizes leitmotifs throughout Herr Ulf to connect the music personally and to draw them inward, the audience inward, to the landscape and emotional terrain of the ballad. In addition to the narrator role, there are four other characters that we encounter, each with their very own specific leitmotif. Oluf, his bride, his mother, and the Earl King's daughter. The audience is drawn into this captivating storyline as the opening bars catapult them immediately into the scene, as Oluf's horse gallops wildly through the darkened forest. He's out inviting guests to his upcoming nuptials. Yet despite this seemingly festive event, the opening dramatic leitmotif betrays the intimacy and inner joy such a celebration should bring. The allegro tempo marking illustrates the pounding of the steed as it comes into view. The ballad begins in E minor, a very dramatic key choice with the forthcoming wedding ceremony. In the opening bars, we are introduced to both Olaf's motif, as well as the deviously twisted and restless elf dance motif. We soon encounter the Earl King's daughter. Eerily similar to the seductive triadic siren call experienced in Erlkönig, the melody of his daughter in Herr Ulf ascends in a tonic chord, E minor in this case, adding the seventh of the chord for extra effect. Also akin to the Earl King's seductive beckon, his daughter's call here is alluring, mysterious, and commanding all at the same time. After two initial temptations to join her dance of death, the daughter of Erlkönig offers Oluf gold as a means of seduction. However, the protagonist is determined to make it through this enchanted forest with his life. Loewe further draws on the interiority of the storyline by painting a new character, that of Oluf's mother, with a motivic figure that emulates her trembling heartbeat, staccato at first, then simply in pianissimo triadic chords. As Oluf answers his mother's nervous questioning, the accompaniment in the bass drops an octave, illustrating both his masculinity as well as his plummeting life force and spirit. When speaking of the Earl King's realm, he manages one last time to achieve a forte phrase as life gradually slips from his body. Sir Olaf's vocal line connotes interiority with its reminiscent emulation of the elf leitmotif in its original E minor. However, it is slightly reduced and diminished in that he can't quite reach the seventh of the chord, and the overall punctuation of text and music is much slower and fatigued than the original sprightly elf dance motif. Interestingly, Loewe chooses to begin the preceding andantino section in the parallel E major, much as he did with Erlkönig from G minor to the Erl King's Haunting, G major. While the singer describes the dawn of Olaf's wedding day and the arrival of guests, the unadorned accompaniment line conjures nostalgic and familiar images of a pastoral scene with its hunting call-like melody. Loewe has brought us full circle, from the extreme outer bounds of the protagonist's surroundings, shown through the natural environs on Olaf's nighttime ride, through his emotional journey, portrayed by the joy of upcoming nuptials, the meeting of the elves, a mother's love, a bride's anticipation, and all the way to the innermost sanctum upon the journey of life itself, death. As opposed to the supernatural subject matter of Goethe's Erlkönig in Herder's Herr Olaf storylines, Die verfallene Mühle draws its basis from a legend and folktale from the long past, once again adhering to this overall theme of looking back and inward. The very definition of interiority and Innerlichkeit refer to dwelling in memory, such as through folktales, focusing inward or on the interior self, and looking at a story or theme through its overall reflective nature. These tales are often conveyed by a character who is alone and facing great loss. Next, as juxtaposed with concepts of temporality and removal from the present, all of which describe the aging Duke in Die verfallene Mühle. The old Duke is introduced in D flat major, a very comforting, familiar sounding key through a one step forward, two steps back leitmotif in the piano. And this choice to begin in a major tonality instantly connotes that the character of the tale is accepting of his age and resigned to dwell in memory. There is little bitterness alluded to here, perhaps a tinge of melancholy. As the story moves past the introspective natural scene, Loewe introduces the concept of hope with a slightly changed vocal line. For the first time, the Duke encounters what may be an indicator of life around him, the discovery of a mill. However, just as quickly as this hope arises, Fogel's text betrays the Duke and conveys that there is no life to be found far and near. The Duke is truly alone. The non-speaking role of the mill plays a major role in numerous ballads and literature of the 18th and 19th centuries, utilized as a tool of passness and to represent a pastoral or rural lifestyle. The solitary character comes upon only a bench within the shambles of the mill, and he chooses to rest his aged and weary body upon it. Now, this too is an allusion to the Innerlichkeit and sense of introspection forced upon the Duke as he experiences the time-ravaged scene surrounding him, reminding him of his own deterioration. Loewe portrays this decline with the gradual diminuendo and pianissimo in the accompaniment, as well as the winnowing down of chord density to simply one note in both the treble and the bass. Loewe brilliantly melds this chain of melancholy surrender into one sparkling with life once again as the mill rises from the shambles of time. The narrator describes this vigorous and vibrant return with a quietly driving eighth against 16th note motif accompanying the vocal line, which also begins with staccato on each note of its phrase. This spirited memory experienced by the Duke is still growing within his mind's eye and begins delicately, as retrospective thoughts and whimsical memories often do. The lively recollection and interiority of the moment escalates with the piano's sudden leap in the treble to the upper reaches of the staff, with the clattering 16th note figure illustrating the forward motion of the mill wheel as it turns and churns, the memory becoming flesh once again in the Duke's vision of the past. Loewe recycles the staccato motif and attaches it to each note, illustrating the light-hearted personality and skipping step of yet another character as she descends the stair, the miller's daughter. With her effervescent entrance and all the warm, romantic, and nostalgic memories it conjures within the Duke, Loewe chooses to modulate to A major, perfectly pairing the emotion of the key signature with the fresh and young daughter. As the narrator describes her face as clear as the heavens or as clear as the sky, Loewe depicts this text with yet another rise in the accompaniment, reaching some of the highest notes of the entire ballad, lifting the text right off the page and into the heavens. Fogel makes a bold choice with his text in the following section, and is yet another reason Loewe's ballad choice seems rooted in Innerlichkeit. The miller's daughter approaches the Duke, and in so doing, breaks that invisible wall between present and past, between introspective nostalgia and reality, between interior and exterior. Just as suddenly as this dreamlike sequence appeared in the mind's eye of the old Duke, the retrospective and Innerlichkeit saturated moment begins to crumble, much like the rambling ruins of the mill surrounding him. Reflected perfectly in Loewe's jagged, accidental laden accompaniment, the Duke fumbles for the glass, yet grasps only air. Much like his inward moments of recollection, the mirage disappears and the illusion is shattered. The composer draws us back to this shambolic scene of the derelict mill as the Duke comes to terms with the fact that his momentary escape was pure interiority, an experience only he encountered that was wholly inward and introspective. As the old Duke mounts his steed to leave this nostalgic and melancholy scene, Loewe exhibits his resignation and acceptance of the present moment with a return to the original key of D-flat major. Thus, this recapitulation is musically retrospective, yet also technically in the present moment for the main character of the folktale. Though he does not make a sound, the Duke wipes a tear from his cheek, painted tenderly and with a bittersweet pang by Loewe's dissonant chord on the word tear. The entirety of the Duke's life, lost loves, memories, and experiences are all represented by this single note in its discordant twang. The character's sadness, mixed with perhaps a touch of remorse, is indicated musically and textually throughout the ballad, exhibiting strong qualities of both interiority and Innerlichkeit in the most basic sense of the term. Der Teufel, Opus 129, was written near the end of Loewe's prolific career. In 1859, the year of composition, the aging artist remained in his position as Kirchenmusikdirektor at St. Jakob's Church in Stettin. And at this point, Loewe had been writing ballads for over 40 years. His lifelong connection to religion and the overwhelming influence this played in every facet of his life is exhibited with his choice of text for this late ballad. Der Teufel contains language and draws its storyline from the Quran, though the text runs parallel to similar accounts found in the Bible. This God versus Satan, or good versus evil plotline, with its focus on the concept of temporality, as well as its qualities of self-redemption, meld congruously with Loewe's sense of interiority and religiously hued poetry, which he chose to utilize throughout his career. At this juncture, in the late 1850s, the genre of the ballad had long passed its zenith. Yet Loewe continued to use it as a tool of inwardness, self-reflection, and his preferred method for storytelling. That just disappeared, like the glass into the air. Do you have any idea?
how to get that back.
I can certainly keep talking, it just won't be.
Undo Dr. Meyerson.
What'd you say?
Undo?
Undo, whatever you did last.
I didn't do anything, it just disappeared. Like that's not on my screen.
It looks like it's the last slide.
Right, but there's nothing on my screen. The screen is blank.
Does that mean your screen is blank?
Sorry. Whatever you just did.
Seems to be good. Okay,
it's back.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you, everyone. Sorry. So as you see here, Löwe begins Der Teufel with very stately and regal-sounding chords in A-flat major. While not immediately as inventive-sounding as Erlkönig, or emotionally taut and melancholic as the introduction to Die Verfallene Mühle, a very heroic and dramatic scene is presented here. This ballad was composed 10 years before the death of Löwe, and only 4 to 5 years before he stopped writing completely. Therefore, the notably less intricate and dense accompaniment, along with the slightly diminished vocal range, portray a composer and performer who is changing his style and use of musical tools and devices to better suit his aging hands and voice. It is documented that Löwe continued to perform his own ballads throughout this period. Thus, it makes logical sense that the pieces grew somewhat more basic and straightforward in their complexity. As the narrator paints the scene of angels gathering around Jehovah, he transfers the treble of the accompaniment outside of the staff for the first time, corresponding with the vocal line's highest note of the ballad, an F4. This opening section of the narrative ballad draws to a close on a tonic A-flat rolled chord, and thus the piece could satisfactorily end here. However, with Löwe's lifelong symbiotic relationship with religion, it's fairly clear he decided and desired to share the full account and storyline with his listener. Thus far, the ballad has walked an especially straightforward path, musically speaking, and employs proportionally fundamental compositional devices to illuminate the text from the Quran. Immediately upon the vocal entrance of Der Teufel, the accompaniment explodes with a forte, ascending cavalcade of notes, joining in triplet unity with the treble. In his attempt to match the angelic tones from the beginning of the ballad, the devil enters on an F4. However, as the scene unfolds, he's never quite able to attain that note again, a detail used to illustrate his eventual decline in power and influence upon the other angels. Löwe sets this section in a far more declamatory vocal style, reminiscent of shouting, with its seemingly random, displaced pitches. The devil's motif is painted through these pitch jumps and the dotted rhythm often associated with them. This choppiness reflecting his anger and resentment with the situation at hand. It is important to note that the devil's second vocal entrance does not quite reach the heights from his initial declamation. Though he is still bombastic in tone and maintains his rhythmic dotted motif, he is slightly diminished, a musical allusion from Löwe to the devil's fate. The character continually sings accidental notes not found in the key signature. And this action goes to further emphasize the devil's instability and inner convictions not aligned with the other angels in Jehovah's orbit. He does not belong with them, much like the accidental does not belong in the given key signature. Upon the devil's fall from grace, a return to the opening motif takes place while the narrator again soars to an F4. Reclaiming that note from Der Teufel and reminding listeners of the angelic strains announcing Jehovah's image before them. Löwe's retrospective compositional style applies here with this full return to the music from the beginning of the ballad. He is, in a sense, returning to the moment of creation, both of this particular ballad, as well as the moment in time when God created Adam and commanded the angels to bow before him. The dynamic direction of dilution and the slowing down of the phrase is a route by which Loewe can once again offer his concept of temporality and the idea that everything eventually fades to nothingness. Just as the music slowly fades, so too does one's physical self and returns to dust or nothingness, according to Loewe's Lutheran Christian view of the world. Unlike the original Quranic account, the composer chooses not to set the voice of Jehovah within his musical rendering. Loewe may have found no need to include God's voice, insinuating his greatness and his enduring strength without uttering a word. One may not hear God physically respond, yet, as the Lutheran view would support, he is there, always with us. This application of religion, with its inherent Innerlichkeit and interiority-inspired motives, reinforce the thesis of this discussion. In conclusion, the following guidelines highlight and support the supposition that all ballads are intrinsically interior, shown through the four included in today's discussion. A ballad's goal is to elicit an emotional response and to insinuate interiority through its performance and reception in generally intimate spaces, such as a home or smaller venue. This goal of a shared emotional response can be attained through the use of retrospective and inward-focused texts with religious or dramatic origins, through an overall sense of temporality or connection to pastness, or by its foundations built on folktales or folklore. Ballads often utilize folk tunes as well, or purposefully familiar-sounding motifs, such as nationalistic melodies, to appeal to a wider audience and draw the listener inward. And finally, these pieces are imbued with interiority through their use of devices of repetition to imitate or intimate memory, as well as their utilization of preludes, interludes, postludes, recitative, leitmotif, and inventive harmonies to bring characters and stories to life, spurring an emotional response and drawing back to the first goal of our ballad. Loewe utilized all of these concepts and tools to a high degree within his ballads to conjure interiority. He performed the majority of his compositions himself, truly the ultimate of inward acts. Loewe's art ballads live on through recordings and occasional performances such as this. However, a closer examination and more frequent inclusion in concert programs is warranted due to their inwardly inventive style and the ballad's emotional comment on the interiority of life, portrayed through their communion with the text. Our final ballad this afternoon comes from Opus 129 from 1859, Der Teufel. Thank you.
Oh.